Hey guys, what's up? So today I'm gonna talk about what it was like growing up as a child star in the 90s. In addition, I'm gonna talk about what representation looked like in the 90s as a child star and what it looks like now. It was very evident to me when I would walk on sets and I would see how certain stars or actors would be treated who weren't of ethnicity. Better dressing room, better trailer. Now I'm like more aware what that was, which is a budget, but back then I didn't know what a budget was. It was so clear how you would see one show that didn't have a diverse cast that just had a bigger budget. So everything just seemed bigger and better. But when it came to my projects and what I was doing, you actually really visually saw the less than. It was even with pay. You know, I was on a television show called Sister Sister, and I remember once the show became a hit, it's very normal for you to ask for a raise. That's what happens, right? People get raises. But it was always so hard for my sister and I to get what we felt like we deserved. And our paycheck never equaled our counterparts that weren't of, you know, diversity. And that was frustrating, very, very frustrating. You know, I have some amazing, amazing friends who are not Black. And after the whole Black Lives Matter movement happened, a lot of them called me and they were like, oh my gosh, Tia, I never knew. And I said, you know what, don't worry about it. How I was treated is why I've built my work ethics. Nothing came easy to me. I always had to work harder than. I've always had to be better than average. And I guess if I didn't go through what I had gone through, or if I didn't see what I had seen when I was a child, I don't think that I would be where I am today, which is a hard freaking worker. Because guess what? It's hard to outwork someone. And that's why I've become such a go-getter. Because I'm like, oh, okay, if that's how it's gonna be, well then I'm gonna show you. I'm gonna get to a place where you can't treat me like that. What was interesting about being, you know, biracial as an actor was how you would be labeled. You would have to fit in some sort of stereotype. I've been told I'm not Black enough, which was very odd and weird to me. You don't look Black enough. I think you would fit more of the Latina role. And it's like, what? These were casting directors who did not understand the different shades of Black culture. These were casting directors, producers, directors, creators that had one vision and one view or one perspective of what a Black girl should look like. Black women are beautiful and we have many different shades to us. We have straight hair, we have curly hair, we have coils, you know, there's just so many different textures to our culture. And I personally didn't like being put into this box of what a Black girl should be or what a Black girl should look like. I didn't like whenever I was portraying a role, I would be told, you need to be more sassy. You need to have more attitude. Excuse me? They were wanting me to hit more on stereotypes. So that was challenging and frustrating because I believe that there are many facets to Black women and who we are as people. And we were just kind of being seen as one particular role and way. You the sassy girl. You the girl with attitude, okay? You can't be the sweet, nice girl. I need for you to have a little bit of sass and a little bit of attitude. And a director actually told me one time on a animated series that I was doing, I need for you to be sassy. And the director had come over and he was amazing. And he said, I am so sorry. I did not like the way he just, you know, asked you to do that. That was inappropriate. You know, and at that time I was like, oh my gosh, thank God that there's someone that gets it and that understands. If you are watching this, Charlie, you know who you are. I appreciate you having my back on that day. And that was years, years ago. And I still remember it. I've learned how to just be a strong woman because of my ancestors. Our history, we were stolen from our country. We were kings. Well, we still are kings and queens, but we were kings and queens. We were stolen from our country and we were put into slavery with no rights. You know, for me, a strong Black woman means someone who has had to have so much strength no matter what her circumstances were around her. She was being raped. Her child was kidnapped and taken from her. Her husband was beaten and killed, and she still had to stand firm and strong because there were two choices. Either you lay down and die, or you still keep your head up high. That perspective and that strength, in my opinion, has been passed down generation from generation. And it's crazy to me how, you know, my great-grandmother was a part of segregation. My grandmother was a part of segregation. My mother had just missed 20 years and her marriage to my dad would have been illegal. If you really put it into perspective that my great-grandmother, my grandmother, and my mother all experienced a lack of equality just because of the color of their skin. That's why I believe that Black women are strong. And when I say Black women are strong, it's because of that. We've learned how to make lemonade out of lemons. And we added some sugar to that. What was so beautiful about, you know, being on television and having a show like Sister Sister and, you know, The Game and Instant Mom is representation. And representation is so important because I've, you know, personally experienced this with myself, even seeing television shows like The Cosby Show and saying, wow, this is a Black family. Like, wow, this is amazing. Like, I can watch this. And it was the same for me. Like, when I would see fans come up to me and say, oh my goodness, you do not know how much you've helped my childhood. Your show brought value. You inspired me to rock my curly hair. You inspired me to be me. And just hearing those stories, it puts a big smile on my face because everything that I do, I want to inspire, to encourage, and to uplift. And knowing that I was able to help young Black girls believe in themselves and believe that they are beautiful and believe that they are valued really makes me feel happy. I'm currently on a show right now called Family Reunion, and you guys, I love working on this show, mainly because I really feel that, number one, it's a show by Netflix, and Netflix really showed how they value the African-American culture. In the African-American culture, church is just evident. It's just something that's a part of our culture. Whether you want to be religious or not, everybody grew up with that praying grandmother. Like, that's just what happens, you know, in a Black family. And again, it just goes back to slavery. This is how we stayed sane. This is how we had to gather hope and strength and to go on when we as a culture were being treated in such a terrible way. We had to find something to attach to give us hope and to give us joy, and that was the church. It's a topic that people don't necessarily always want to embrace because it's like religion. They were not afraid to show that side of our African-American culture, and not only that, show the side of police brutality, which was a very hard episode for me to do because we were talking about, you know, the reality of what happens to some young, old Black males. But what I love about Netflix is they weren't afraid to tackle these controversial subjects. Those subjects are true to what our culture is going through. And that's what makes it so inspiring. What's also really great is this was the first show where, besides Sister Sister, where I was encouraged to wear my natural curly hair. You know, when I was doing Sister Sister, I had curly hair. And what was interesting was once my sister and I, you know, got older and we wanted to be viewed as sexy, we would straighten our hair. I went on to do so many other television shows and I would always wear my hair straight because I was insecure about my curly hair. These insecurities came because I didn't see these images, meaning women with curly hair and their natural hair being portrayed as beautiful. I remember my sister, she had gone out on an audition. She didn't book the part because the casting director said that her hair was a distraction. When you're hearing this, and then you're not seeing these images being portrayed as beauty, it makes you feel insecure. So one of the main reasons why I enjoy doing Family Reunion is the executive producer is like, girl, show off your natural curls. Your hair is beautiful. You are beautiful just the way you are. And it took how long to do that? Which is still mind-blowing to me, but I think that shows you the power of representation, how it's so important to put out images that inspire you to be yourself, embrace who you are, and not what society thinks or calls what beauty is. We have a huge Black writing staff. I've been a part of many Black television shows that didn't have a lot of writers that knew how to adequately and authentically tell our stories. We have a beautiful culture, and how you represent these stories or express these stories, you kind of have had to live through them. It's nice to be able to have a writer write in a character getting his hair cut by a barber at his house on his porch. Because that's how we roll, you know? It's just little kind of authentic stories like that that resonates to an audience, making it real and authentic. I think what was so great about Sister Sister was maybe if we didn't touch on those controversial topics, having two young Black girls be the star of their own show spoke volumes. Which I am forever grateful to have been given that opportunity. I think it's amazing when my daughter can watch these programs and my son can watch these programs and see themselves. You guys, I have tried to get my son to watch my movies and my shows. He loves his uncle, Taj. So he's watched his programs like Hounded and all of these other programs. I sat down and watched Twitches with him. I mean, come on, you guys, Twitches. Twitches. Go Twitches. Go Twitches. Next. But you know what he loves to watch? Tia Mowry's Quick Fix. He will watch Tia Mowry's Quick Fix all day, every day. He like binge watches it, and I think it's the cutest thing. The show that my son loves to sit down and watch is Family Reunion. And that makes me feel good, you know, because this is a great family show where he can be inspired, learn, and laugh, which is great entertainment in my opinion. I've been introducing my son to a lot of the movies that I've grown up watching. I introduced him to The Wiz, and he absolutely loved that. I introduced him to Family Matters, and he loves that show. He binged watched, my gosh, I want to say like all 9 seasons in like, I think like a few days. I was like, Cree, what are you watching? Family Matters. His favorite character is Steve Urkel. And Jaleel was amazing. He actually called my son as a surprise for his birthday because he's a huge fan of Jaleel. So it matters when you have programs that you can resonate with. The thing that's powerful about television in general is when you can watch a television show, you as a parent may not know how to express a controversial topic, but through the art of television, it's kind of laid out beautifully for you. It tells a story. after watching the episode about police brutality on Family Reunion, he'd already talked to him about police brutality before, but it was a great way to continue our conversation and bring awareness about the topic in a very healthy manner and not so, you know, overwhelming or create some sort of anxiety for him. So I think that shows how important representation is. Thank you so much for listening to my experiences, my stories. I hope you can learn from them. I hope that you can get strength from them. Just never give up, you guys. Always be you. Don't forget to subscribe to Tia Mowry's Quick Fix for more videos. If you haven't seen my video on growing up biracial, make sure you check it out.